नमस्ते, माई सर त्रिवेणी खुराना, असिस्टेंट प्रोफेसर, फैकल्टी फिजियोथेरेपी एंड रिहैब, त्रिवेणी राजस्थान. टुडेज टॉपिक इज पीटी इन क्रेनियोटमी. लेट्स ओवरलुक अबाउट क्रेनियोटमी. क्रेनियोटमी इज अ सर्जरी टू कट अ बोनी ओपनिंग इन द स्कल. अ सेक्शन ऑफ द स्कल कॉल्ड अ बोन फ्लैप इज रिमूव टू असेस द ब्रेन अंडरनीथ. A craniotomy may be small or large depending on the problem. It may be performed to treat brain tumor, hematomas, aneurysm, OAVMs, traumatic head injury, foreign objects, swelling of the brain, or infection. The bone flap is usually replaced at the end of the procedure with tiny plates and screws. Craniotomies are named according to the area of the skull, that is cranium, to be removed. After the surgeon repairs the problem, the bone flap is then replaced or covered with plates and screws. If the bone flap is not replaced, the procedure is called craniectomy. Craniotomies vary in size and complexity. Small diameter craniotomies are called burr holes. Keyhole craniotomies are quarter-sized or larger. Stereotactic frames, image-guided computer system, and endoscopes may be used to precisely place instruments through these small holes. Burr holes and keyholes are used for minimally invasive procedure to insert a shunt into the ventricle to drain cerebrospinal fluid to treat hydrocephalus, insert a deep brain stimulator, to insert an intracranial pressure monitor, to remove a sample of tissue cells for needle biopsy, to drain a blood clot, hematoma aspiration, and to insert an endoscope to remove tumors. Complex skull-based craniotomies involve the removal of bone that supports the bottom of the brain, where delicate cranial nerves, arteries, and veins exit the skull. Reconstruction of the skull base may require the additional expertise of head and neck, otologic, or plastic surgeons. Surgeons often use image guidance system to plan the access for difficult-to-reach lesions to remove deep brain tumors, AVMs, clip aneurysms, and to remove tumors that inhibit the bony skull. While most skull openings are made as small as possible, large decompressive craniectomies are made to allow the brain to swell after a head trauma or stroke. The bone flap is frozen and replaced months later after recovery, that is cranioplasty. Awake craniotomies are performed when a lesion is close to critical speech areas. Patient is asleep for the bone opening and then awakened to help the surgeons map areas at risk. A probe is placed on the brain surface while patient read or talk. Called brain mapping, this process identifies brain areas for speech and helps the surgeon avoid and protect these functions. There are many kinds of craniotomies. Ask neurosurgeon to describe where the skin incision will be made and the amount of bone removal. Now, who performs the procedure? Craniotomy is performed by a neurosurgeon. Some have additional training in skull-based surgery. Neurosurgeon may work with a team of head and neck, otologic, oculoplasty, and reconstructive surgeons. Ask neurosurgeon about their training, especially if your case is complex. Now, what happens before surgery? The surgeon will explain the procedure, its risks and benefits, and patient will have time to ask questions. Consent forms are signed and paperwork is completed to inform the surgeon about medical history regarding allergies, medicines, anesthesia reaction, and previous surgeries. Pre-surgical tests include blood tests, electrocardiogram, chest x-rays may need to be done several days before surgery. Consult primary care physician about stopping certain medications and ensure you are clear for the surgery. Stop taking all non-steroidal anti-inflammatory medicine, example ibuprofen or naproxen, and blood thinners. 7 days before search. Stop using nicotine and drinking alcohol 1 week before and 2 weeks after surgery to avoid bleeding and healing problems. If image guided surgery is planned, an MRI will be scheduled before surgery. Fiducials, that is small markers, may be placed on your forehead and behind the ears. The markers help align the preoperative MRI to the image guidance system. The fiducials must stay in place and cannot be moved or removed prior to surgery to ensure the accuracy of the scan. Patient may ask to wash skin and hair with Epicense or Dial soap before surgery. It kills bacteria and reduces surgical site infections. Avoid getting CTH in eye, ear, nose and genital areas. On the morning of surgery, no food, no drink, no gum or no candy. Shower using antibacterial soap. Dress in freshly washed, loose-fitting clothing. Wear flat-heeled shoe with closed backs. If you have instructions to take regular medication, morning of surgery to soak with small sips of water. Remove makeup, hair pin, hair extension, weaves, contacts, body piercings and nail polish. Leave all valuables and jewelry at home. Bring a list of medication with dosages and the times of day usually taken. Bring a list of allergies to medications of food. Patients are admitted to the hospital the morning of the surgery. The nurse will explain the preoperative procedure and discuss any questions patient may have. An anesthesiologist will take with patient to explain the effects of anesthesia and its risks. Now, what happens during surgery? Depending on the underlying problem being treated, the surgery can take 3 to 5 hours or longer. Step 1 is prepare the patient. Patient will lie on the operating table and we give general anesthesia. Once patient sleeps, head is placed in a 3-pin skull fixation device that attaches to the table and holds head absolutely still during surgery. A brain relaxing drug called mannitol may be given. If image guidance is used, head will be registered with the infrared cameras to correlate the real patient to the 3D computer model created from MRI scans. The system functions as a GPS to help plan the craniotomy and locate the lesion. Instruments are detected by the cameras and displayed on the computer model. Step 2 is make a skin incision. The incision area of the scalp is prepared with an antiseptic. Skin incisions are usually made behind the hairline. Hair sparing technique is used where only a 1x4 inch wide area along the proposed incision is shaved. Sometimes the entire incision area may be shaved. Step 3. Perform a craniotomy. Open the skull. The skin and muscles are lifted off the bone and folded back. Next, small burr holes are made in the skull with a drill. The burr holes allow entrance of a special saw called craniotom. Similar to using a jigsaw saw, the surgeon cuts an outline of a bone window. The cut bone flap is lifted and removed to expose the protective covering of the brain called the dura. The bone flap is safely set aside and will be replaced at the end of the surgery. Step 4 is expose the brain. The dura is open to expose the brain. Retractors may be used to gently open a corridor between the brain and skull. Surgeons use magnification glasses or an operating microscope to see the delicate nerves and vessels. Step 5. Correct the problem. Enclosed inside the bony skull, the brain cannot be easily moved aside to access and repair problems. Neurosurgeons use a variety of very small instruments to work deep inside the brain. These include long-headed scissors, dissectors and drills, lasers and ultrasonic aspirators, which uses a fine jet of water to break up tumor and suction up the pieces. In some cases, evoked potential monitoring is used to stimulate specific cranial nerves while the response is monitored in the brain. This is done to preserve function of the nerve during surgery. Step 6. Close the craniotomy. After the problem has been removed or repaired, any retractors are removed and the dura is closed with sutures. The bone flap is put back in its original position and secured to the skull with titanium plates and screws. The plates and screws remain permanently to support the area and the sometimes can be felt under the skin. A drain may be placed under the skin for a couple of days to remove blood or fluid from the area. The muscles and skin are sutured back together. Soft adhesive dressing is placed over the incision. Now what happens after surgery? Patient taken to the recovery room where vital signs are monitored as patient awake from anesthesia. Patient may have a sore throat from the tube used to assist with breathing. After awaken, patient is moved to the intensive care unit for close monitoring. Patient frequently asked to move finger, arm, toe and leg. Nurse will check your pupil with a flashlight and ask questions such as what is your name. Patient may experience nausea and headache after surgery. Medication can control these symptoms. Depending on the type of brain surgery, steroid medications to control brain swelling and anticonvulsant medication to prevent seizure may be given. When condition stabilizes, patient transfer to a regular room where patient will begin to increase activity level. The length of the hospital stay varies from only 2 to 3 days or 2 weeks, depending on the surgery and any complications. When released from the hospital, patient given discharge instructions. Follow the surgeon's home care instructions for 2 weeks after surgery or until follow-up appointment. In general, patient can expect restrictions regarding don't lift anything heavier than 5 pounds. No strenuous activity including yard work, housework and sex too. Don't drink alcohol. It thins the blood and increases the risk of bleeding. Also, don't mix alcohol with pain medicines. Don't smoke or use nicotine products. Vape, dip or chew. It may delay healing. Don't drive, return to work or fly air travel until surgeon says it's okay. Now, incision care. Patient may shower the day after surgery and wash hair with mild baby shampoo. Gently wash the incision area with soap and water every day. Don't scrub or let the water beat hard on the incision. Parts should remain dry. If trauma wound skin glue covers incision, don't rub or pick at the glue. Don't submerge or soak the incision in bath, pool or tub. Don't apply lotion or ointment on the incision, including hair styling products. Patient may hear strange noises, popping, cracking, ringing inside head. This is normal healing as the air and fluid may absorb. Don't color hair for 6 weeks. If cut hair, use lotion near the incision. Now regarding medicines, headaches are common after surgery and patient may take acetaminophen. Take pain medicines as directed by surgeon. Reduce the amount and frequency as pain subsides. If don't need the pain medicine, don't take it. Narcotics can cause constipation. Drink lots of water and eat high fiber foods. Stool softeners and laxatives can help move the bowel. Colix, Senogard and Dulocol, Miraglax are over-the-counter options. Anti-seizure medicines may be prescribed. Some patients develop side effects such as drowsiness, balance problems or rashes. Don't take anticipatory pain relievers, blood thinners or supplements without surgeon's approval. Now what is about activity? Get up and walk 5 to 10 minutes every 3 to 4 hours. Gradually increase walking as you are able. Swelling and bruising of the eye or face may occur. It will take several weeks to go away. Sleep with head elevated and apply ice 3 to 4 times per day for 15 to 20 minutes to help reduce pain and swelling. Red signs or red flags. Fever over 101.5. which is unrelieved by Tylenol. Signs of incision infection such as spreading redness, separation or color drainage. Increased drowsiness, weakness of arm or legs, increased headache, vomiting or severe neck pain that prevents lowering chin to chest. New or worsening vision, speech or confusion. Swelling at the incision with leaking of clear fluid from the eye or nose. Swelling and tenderness in the calf of one leg and seizure. Now, recovery period. A follow-up appointment is made 10 to 14 days after surgery. The recovery time varies from 1 to 4 weeks depending on the underlying disease being treated and general health. Full recovery may take up to 8 weeks. Walking is a good way to begin increasing your activity level. Do not overextend yourself, especially if continued treatment with radiation or chemotherapy. What are the risks? No surgery is without risk. General complications of many surgeries include bleeding, infection, blood clot, and reactions to anesthesia. Specific complications related to craniotomy may include stroke, seizure, swelling of the brain, nerve damage, cerebrospinal fluid leak, and loss of some mental functions too. The result of craniotomy depends on the underlying conditions being treated. Physiotherapy is an integral part of neurological rehab team, and neurological physiotherapy is an integral part. The physiotherapy program may require input from a range of clinicians. It should be directed at professionals with experience in the management of neurological conditions. It is a process of interlock assessment, treatment and management by which individuals with traumatic brain injury and their related caregivers are supported to achieve the best possible outcome in physical, cognitive, social and psychological function, participation in society and quality of life. Discharge plan starts at an early stage of rehab and overlaps. Recovery of function following brain damage can occur in two processes. Spontaneous recovery, which is the process related to the repair of CNS early after brain injury and regression of dead caches. And the second one is functional induced recovery, process based on the promoting neuroplasticity in response to activity practice and environmental stimulation leading to behavioral change, like in the constraint induced movement therapy training program. Thank you.